All right, what's up, party people, and welcome to the Draft Analyst Podcast. And I'm your host, Steve Cornianos, and today is Tuesday, October 5th, 2021. And I want to thank you all for listening in. And you can find this podcast on SoundCloud, iTunes, and Spotify, Twitter at the Draft Analyst, YouTube Prospect Film Room, and the free draft blog is thedraftanalyst.com. All right, today, episode number 173, we're going to talk about the Pittsburgh Penguins, and we're going to preview their upcoming season. Had a new GM last year replacing Jim Rutherford, who stepped down. And so now they got Ron Hextall running the show. He's been running the show since February, right? Early February. And then he kind of has Brian Burke alongside as kind of a president slash advisor, whatever you want to call it. Some of these positions are just really glorified. And you know, it's kind of weird. There's so many cooks in kitchens, in the kitchen, in the NHL front office. It's crazy. And I'm wondering, you have to ask yourself, in the end, now, obviously, the Pens don't apply to this because they've been a very successful franchise the last, what, 20-something years. All close to that. But imagine being a losing organization. Like, you don't generate shit. Like, I'm sure they make a profit some way or another, but that you have all these people on staff. You're paying them, all paying them somewhere upwards of, like, $85,000 to, like, $250,000, $300,000 a year, depending on the jobs and the team. You got to have lawyers and ad types, ad executives, and marketing, and PR, communications, and security, and tickets, sales, like you name it, medical staff. You're paying these people just tons of money, and the team just blows. And you're like, what's the point? I personally can never work and just be happy to collect a paycheck for like a losing organization. I can never do that because it'd be like, oh yeah, you work for that team that sucks ass. Yeah, I work for them, but I get paid. Yeah, well, and it's like the whole Office Space thing. Like, what would you say you frickin' do? I'm not saying it's not an easy position to be in. If they're going to offer you a paycheck to work for a shitty team, you frickin' take it. I'm just saying, personally, I'd much rather work for a winning team or a team that does things the right way. And the Pittsburgh Penguins do things the right way. I'd want to work for the Pittsburgh Penguins. Whether you want to say, well, you know, it's easy when you have Sidney Crosby getting Malkin. Hey, listen, a lot of teams draft high picks. The Penguins are on a run. They've been an elite team for quite a long time, almost two decades worth. That's not easy to do. And it's not like when they make the playoff, like they have this playoff streak, right, that began in 2007. Really, the Evgeny Malkin's rookie year, Sid's second year, that was a dominant year. Remember, he won the Hart, the Ross. And since then, not only have the Pens been a playoff team, but they've been pretty much a cup contender every season. There was that one year, was it 2000, and I want to say it was 15, where it was like the lowest ebb of this run, where the Pens were able to get into the playoffs. I think they played the Rangers in the first round. The Rangers won the President's Trophy. So that was really the only sin. Of course, they ended up losing. Was it the Carl Hagelin overtime winner sent the Pens packing? And that was when everyone was like, oh, Sid's done. Malkin's done. They got to break everything, deconstruct everything and start fresh. And they kind of did in a way because they won the next two Stanley Cups. And ever since that poor showing, I guess, in 2015, they've been one of the best teams in the league, if not the best team in the league, points percentage-wise. That's pretty long, a pretty big sample size. It's like a six-year sample size since winning their last cup. Or since, that first-round exit to the Rangers in 2015. And they've been great. The issue with the Pens the last few years is because they have a demanding fan base. When you win cups, the fans expect to see that or something close to that every season. And the Pens have been the opposite since winning that second cup, or the third cup since 2009, but the second of back-to-backs in 2017 against Nashville. That since then, 2018, they beat the Flyers in the first round. Big deal. Interstate rival. Pens and Flyers always hate each other. Always exciting hockey. And then they had to face the Caps. And the Caps have been the Penguins' bitch. For how long? Pimping them out, really. Since, go back to the frickin' 90s. The Caps had really good. Every time the Caps had a good team, the Pens were always there to stop it. The only time I remember the Caps actually, besides obviously winning in 2018, But maybe I'm forgetting one, but I think the one exception was 94 when the Pens and the Caps were playing in the first round again. This was no Patrick division. This is the new setup now, the Eastern Conference. This was the first year that I think it was Gary Bettman. It might have been Gary Bettman's second year, but this was the first year where the league got rid of the old school division format and went with the conferences like the NBA. And so that was, you know, the previous season, 93, the Pens were the best team in hockey, won the President's Trophy, expected to three-peat, lose to the Islanders in round two in Game 7. David Volek's overtime went okay, bad memories. And then, but still, on paper, the Pens were a powerhouse. And that was the year when Mario, I don't know if that was cancer or back-related, but in any event, 93-94, the Caps played the Pens in the playoffs again, and that was the one time the Caps were able to pull it off. I think Mario might have played one or two games in that series. And then 94-95, they lose to, I believe, the Devils. Don't think Mario took part in that. 95-96, that was the whole, you know, you got upset by Florida, and was it Game 7 at home? Conference final, should have went to the Cup. Should have been a Colorado-Pittsburgh Stanley Cup final in 96. And then, of course, Mario kind of retires in 97. I think they lost to, I want to say they lost to Buffalo. Or was it Philly that they beat? And maybe it was round one or round two, I forgot. But anyway, I'm not going to go down to the hill history of the Penguins. I'm just saying that when it came to the Caps, that they own them outside of that one exception. And so the Caps finally, you know, they got revenge in 2018. But since then, since beating the Flyers in round one in 2018, it's been pretty bad for the Pens playoff-wise. But it doesn't match up with what they've done in the regular season. I think that's the problem. Once again, last year they were 37-16-3 for 77 points. First in the East Division. They won the division. I think it was their first division title in about 5 or 6 years. They were on a 53-win, 113-point pace. I mean, that's outstanding. Mike Sullivan, you know, and I made the comment, like, he should be done after losing to the Islanders in the first round. Again, losing the first round. But the dude's 251, 131, and 43. Now entering his seventh season as Penn's head coach. So you better be damn sure, if you fire that guy, you better be damn sure you bring someone in that's capable to keep this going. Because you ask anybody around the league, they would be more than happy to take on the Penn struggles, which is really only usually within like a 7 to 10 day period during the postseason. That's it. The regular season. All right. The thing about the regular season is the Pens always have these ups and downs, right? Where before the season, I'm sure I've talked about it too, where you say, man, I don't know, getting old, poor farm system, trading away all their draft picks. Think about this might be the year. This might be the year. The Pens are going to suck. And every year they find a way to either exceed expectations or shut up critics, or both. And so last year was no different. I mean, again, we said the same thing. Crosby's getting older. Malkin's getting older. Letang's getting older. What are they going to do? Oh, you know, Fleury's gone. And Matt Murray's gone. They made all these changes. And then they were last year. One of the best seasons they've had in recent memory, and they did it without Matt Murray there. They did it with the same old shit that we have to deal with every year, or that they deal with every year. And once again, the Pittsburgh offense carried the load. One of the top offenses in the league. We know that, right? And it's almost like a knee-jerk reaction to say that the Pens automatically assume that the Penguins, because they're, you know, such a high-powered offense, and those 2 years where they won the Cup, they didn't have the best defense, at least statistically. But last season was the ninth time in the last 14 years where the Penguins finished in the top 13 or better, or within the top 13, in goals allowed. Yeah, they leaked scoring chances. They play a run-and-gun style. Their defensemen have to be ready. Because even in the playoffs, what I've noticed is that the issue in the postseason isn't so much, I know we like to say, well, it's the goaltending and yeah, it's the defense. I disagree. I think the issue since 2017 has been the offense in the postseason. Now, there was that one game, was it game 5 against the Islanders or game 4? I forgot which game it was. It was a critical game where the Pens doubled up the Islanders on shots. It was like 54 to 25 or some shit like that. And I remember tweeting about it and talking about it because that was a really good playoff series. The issue with that playoff series, I guess the main story was Jarry and the goaltending. He sucked. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The kid sucked. And he could bounce back from that. But the offense seems to dry up in the postseason. You can't have a top five offense or top seven offense every year, average 3.5 to 4 goals a game or whatever it's been. And then when the playoffs arrive, then that all goes away. And I don't know why. It just does. They've scored 3 goals or less in 19 of their last 20 playoff games. The one exception being the 5-4 win in game 3 or game 2 this year, whenever it was. And they've lost 15 of their last 19 playoff games, and they're 0-4 in their playoff series since beating Philly in round 1 in 2017-18. Now, Murray, since winning the Cup in 17, he had some issues in the playoffs, right? He wasn't all that good in the Cap series in 2018. Wasn't good at all in 2019 when he got swept by the Islanders. Wasn't good in the playing round, the upset with Montreal. He got outplayed by Carey Price. Okay, no shame in that, but still the Pens. It was a 5-12 matchup. Pens should have won that one. And then, of course, Jarry with his issues last year. But again, I think the idea was that, hey, listen, these goalies, whether it be Fleury or Murray or Jarry, that these goalies have proven that they need run support or, goal support, that they're not elite goalies. Now, obviously, Fleury's had this, resurgence towards the end of his career, but Marc-Andre Fleury was never a guy we would consider to be at the point in terms of his reputation around the league during this particular generation, right? He was never a Brodeur or a Wah or a Hasek or a Belfour or a Henrik Lundqvist or a Carey Price. He was always just kind of there. Now, yeah, he won cups, but a lot of that had to do with the supporting cast, I think. And that's been the issue. So what happens when that supporting cast can't deliver in the postseason like they did the regular season? It's going to fall on the goalie to start stealing games, and I don't think those goalies are really equipped to do it. Now, of course, Murray stole games, but I'm saying since these struggles began, that part of the problem is the Pens aren't scoring and the goalies aren't stealing games. And that the goals that they're giving up are coming at the worst possible time, right? Where the Pens will have like a 15. And again, I don't have the numbers to back this up in terms of, I'm just saying when I watch the Pens play in the playoffs, I'll say it was almost similar to the Toronto Maple Leafs, where they will dominate chunks of a specific game. Now, it's hard to do that against the Islanders because they're such a good balanced team. But even still, there were moments in the playoff series last year where I felt that the Pens were the better team, the Islanders were on their heels, and then Chai would let up a fucked up goal. So whose fault is it? Is it the Penguins' forwards' fault for not finishing with all these chances that they've been generating? Or is it Jarry's fault for not saying, hey, listen, the Islanders or this opponent is a very good defensive team. I'll handle it. I'll keep it to like 1 or 2 goals, and that should be enough for you guys. You guys should be able to score 2-3 goals. Because that's the thing, the Pens don't really win. They haven't been winning those 2-1, 1-0, 3-2 games. And it's not about effort. It's not tiny heart syndrome. It's not that they're jinxed. None of that shit. I think it's a combination of things. Can the Pens reinvent themselves and say, you know what? Let's be more of a 200-foot kind of a team where we maybe focus less on attacking and aggressiveness on the forecheck. Maybe be a little bit more passive. I don't know. But they give up about, 32 shots a game in the playoffs. That's counting overtime. Whereas in the regular season, it's around the same, give or take. And that's with only a short overtime. Whereas in the playoffs, that number gets, inflated if you have, a 2 overtime, double overtime or whatever. But they haven't played that many games in overtime since winning the last cup against Nashville. So that's basically where we're at. Outstanding team. playoff streak that's been around since 2007. One of the top, every year, top five, top eight teams in the league. Always considered dangerous. They also seem to find a way to peak during the March-April timeframe, right? Or maybe a little bit before that. Where there's always a point, it seems, where the Pens might win a couple games. Everybody goes bananas and says, oh no, the sky's falling. And then the Pens say, we're not going anywhere just yet. And they turn it on. And it validates their reputation as a powerhouse in the league. I don't think teams are afraid of them like they might have been in the past. Because it's not like a massive disparity. They also play in a very tough division. Well, you could argue right now they have at least six teams that could crack the 95-point mark or higher. I saw some stat today. It's one of these analytics sites, and I don't follow them. No offense to the analytics types out there. To me, analytics, there's certain specific stats that I like, right? But as far as like having some type of projection model that's going to say, well, I'm going to use these analytics and I'm going to say this team's going to finish this way. To me, it's no different than throwing darts blindfolded or doing 50 hours worth of research on a given team and saying, hey, I've done all the research and this is where I've come to this conclusion. And so as someone who's been spending 2 days apiece, if not longer, like researching the shit out of one specific team. So it's every day is always a couple days worth where I'm going through significant factors that relate to wins and losses, right? The schedule, the salary cap, the roster, the additions, the dynamic, the coaching, the farm system, you name it. Situational shit, head-to-head results, all that crap I look into. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm saying this is what I do. And, you know, I could come up with the same type of projection. Or I could come up with a projection that might look different than the analytic one. And so I saw one today that had the fucking Devils finishing ahead of the Penguins. And as someone who's previewed the Devils already, like, listen, they got Dougie Hamilton, they got Ryan Graves, and they got fucking Jonathan Bernier. I like the Devils a lot. They're a lot of fun. It would be a shock if they cracked the 85-point mark, let alone finish second or third in the toughest division in hockey and leapfrog the Islanders and the Penguins. That's a fucking take right there. Because although the Penguins have a couple of things going against them this year, particularly, you know, playing the first quarter of the season without Sidney Crosby and Evgeny Malkin because they're hurt, you have to realize that this group, and the core is still there, the top six is still one of the best top sixes in hockey, the top four defense is still one of the better top four defenses in the league, in terms of at least, you know, notoriety, personnel, effectiveness, whatever. Coming off a 53-win, 113-point pace, the losses they had in the offseason versus the additions, minor. They were minor. Key guys, but they were key depth guys. They didn't lose any of their top six. You know, they lose some energy guys, some grit guys. Okay, that happens. But that's not, losing a grit guy is not going to say, oh shit, we're a fucking 85-point team now because we lost Brandon Tanev and Jared McCann. Like, no, that doesn't happen. You need a whole bunch of shit to happen for a team that's been pacing at 47 to 53 wins and 105 to 113 points the last 5-6 years. Oh, by the way, there's people on this group that have won Stanley Cups. And then, you know, to come to the conclusion that all that's going to collapse because they lost two bottom six forwards. I think it might be three. Who am I forgetting? Jankowski. So Jankowski, McCann, and Tanev. And Cody Ceci. So we're going to say that the Pens are going to take a, you know, 20-point hit in the standings because of their losses? I don't see it happening. I see the Pens doing once again what they've done every year, and that is at some point in the season, the second people doubt them, they'll turn it on, and they'll start annihilating the opposition. Now, Crosby and Malkin are both out of camp. They're going to miss the start of the season. I saw a report that Crosby's skating. He's been skating. Malkin can't. Obviously, it's a knee issue. I don't know if Malkin's been skating, but Malkin's knee surgery, I believe, was in June. And Crosby had, I think, wrist surgery in September, I think. So Malkin, he was the first domino to fall, where they said, hey, June, surgery, bam, he's done for a while. Don't hold your breath. He'll be back some point in the season. Crosby, he came out, I think, in September. We're already into early October. He's skating. It's a wrist injury, so obviously he could skate. And so he'll probably miss, I would say, 7 to 10 days, but expect them both to be at midseason form when you want them to be in midseason form, you know, sometime around like mid to late January, early February. And then you got the whole Olympic break. So that's going to help them as well. Get them some game action, give them a chance to rest up, heal up, strengthen their wrist, knee, whatever it's going to be. Now, the question is, and this is something that's a legitimate question. Now, remember, this is coming from someone that is not a big NHL is at the Olympics like fan. I'm not. I grew up with the kids at the Olympics versus the European pros. I always liked the setup. It was kind of cool because you knew that, yeah, it wasn't the best on best, but it was still pretty cool to see these young guys play and get the spotlight for once, you know, in a national stage. And, you know, we've already seen the best on best, right? Beginning in 98. I don't like that they stopped the season at all. But the thing to keep an eye on is Malkin and Crosby going to the Olympics. I'm pretty sure that both Russia and Canada, and I'm going to call them Russia, I'm not going to call them OAR, whatever the stupid name. How dumb of a freaking penalty is that? Oh, you guys did steroids and cheated? Well, you can't say Russia and you can't call yourselves Russia. You can't have your flag at the event. Just fucking ban them. What kind of dumb shit is that? Stupid people. But anyway, I'm of the opinion that Crosby and Malkin should definitely not go to the Olympics. Absolutely not. That those 3 weeks or 4 weeks, for them in particular, at their age, and coming off of significant injuries, they need that time to, you know. Now, you might, there's, the other half is going to say, well, they missed all that time. They already rested up. You know, Malkin didn't have a training camp. He's been, you know, resting and strengthening. So maybe if he's playing his best hockey of his season up until the Olympics, maybe it'll be best for him to keep going and go there and play for Russia. I don't know. I don't know if I agree with that. I think that you want these guys. The one thing we've noticed about the Pens, if you're losing the first round, you're not scoring, you have to factor in that maybe fatigue is part of it. That, you know, Sid especially, where there were times he's looked really frustrated against a team like the Islanders. That maybe it would be good for Sid to get that extra month off, right? Play from, he's coming back soon, but let's just say he starts in late October, early November. You get 3.5 full months in, you're at midseason form, and then you get a break and you recharge. And I've talked about in the podcast before about being in your mid-30s. The mid-30s is when you hit that wall. I don't know if it's scientific or not. All I can tell you is that it just seems like everyone I talk to, you know, I hung around a lot of people that were athletic, not necessarily team sport-wise, or people that ran, people that were, you know, obviously, you know, involved in whatever sport, but not really on an elite level. Just saying most of my friends were athletic one way or another. And that when you hit your mid-30s, it's like we all have the same conversation. Like, shit, man. Man, I've been pushing myself. I've been, you know, now, like Tom Brady. He's one of those guys where he gets better with age. That happens. Okay, I'm not saying it's impossible. And Sid, of course, had a hard caliber season last year. And Malkin was, you know, when he's on, he's one of the best players in the game. But in terms of, like, recovery time's a lot longer. And that's why I think it's important for these guys to be really at 100% for the postseason. Because this narrative is getting a little frustrating. Where great regular season, you lose early in the playoffs, and you're losing, you know, because of a variety of reasons, not just one particular one. Yeah, the goaltending is one of the bigger reasons, but I already talked about the offense problem as well. So just like I said, just throwing that out there. Now, if there's any positive that comes out of Crosby and Malkin being out, besides the fact that the schedule is kind of favorable in that beginning portion of the season, we'll talk about that later on, is that all these young kids at the depends like some teams in the league, but not like it's not a common tactic that the Pens, they like to keep their prospects in the AHL for as long as possible. And they keep re-signing them to two-way deals, one-year deals. They keep bringing back the same names. There are guys in Wilkes-Barre that will be in Wilkes-Barre this year. They've been there for 5-6 years or something close to that. Well, the injuries now, because the Pens weren't that very active in the offseason. They don't have a lot of cap space. We'll talk about that too. So I think that this is the best chance we'll see, well, what we've had in quite some time, where these Wilkes-Barre Scranton types, the Almeidas and the Bell Reeves and the Felix Roberts or Robert, whatever it is, they're going to have a chance to get some minutes and not just like 8 minutes a game. Like your top two centers are going to probably be Jeff Carter. There's going to be one of them. He'll be your top line center to start the season. Okay, that's a pretty good top line center, but he's also like, you know, 35, 34 years old. And then one of, what, Teddy Bluger, Brian Boyle, who's on a PTO, but he's probably going to get signed. Evan Rodriguez, who's going to be your second-line center? You never had this problem before. It's been a while, right? I think there might have been when Sid had the concussion issues in the early 2010s, there might have been a point where both Malkin and Crosby were out, and the Pens had issues. But as a fan of a team whose farm system gets beat up every year, and understandably so, you guys trade all your picks. You've had some bad luck at the draft. The Pens draft 4 to 5 guys every year, while every other team is drafting 7 to 8. So that's why you're behind the power curve in that regard. But look at Jake Ensel. Look at Brian Rust. They were in the minor leagues for a long time. And I've said it before, I'm not buying the thing that it's because of Crosby and Malkin. It definitely helps playing with them. But there have been a lot of players who've been on the same line as an elite generational talent and did shit with it. So the fact that Gensel and Russ are able to become, you know, some of the best players in the league at their respective positions, or, you know, noteworthy, productive, use whatever superlative you want, that says a lot about, as much about them as it does about Crosby and Malkin, in my opinion. So we'll see some of these guys. I think there's always one law of averages that at least one of these kids is going to surprise. And say, hey, you know what? I kind of like playing 16 minutes a game in the NHL. I don't want to go anywhere. I want to stay here. Yeah, Wilkes-Barre Scranton's nice. Good people. But I kind of like Pittsburgh better. So, yes, they play in a tough division. Yes, they'll be without their two superstars to start. Yes, the goaltending was scrutinized because of the postseason. But you cannot count the Penguins out. The Penguins have to be like 10 points out of a playoff spot with about 20 games left before you could really start counting them out. And even then, you're like, I don't know. They got those 5 easy games. If they win all 5 of those games, they're right back in the thick of things. And then you're faced with the prospect of playing a cup caliber team who dealt with, and I'm talking about perfect storm scenarios where, you know, the Penguins really have injuries, people don't produce, regression, goaltending issues, coach gets fired, you name it, that even if that kind of a team is able to kind of band together and sneak into the playoffs, there's not going to be a single team that's like, oh, thank God we're playing them in the playoffs. No, you always got to worry about teams like that. All right, so let's talk about the roster, right? We already kind of like touched on it a little bit, but let's go over the moves that they've made. Not many, not a whole lot of wiggle room because of the cap. But I actually like the additions they brought in. So we already talked about who they dropped. Jared McCann, I kind of like that move, even though Jared McCann's a good player and he was effective. He was all up and down the lineup. I remember he played on the power play. He played in the top six. He played in the bottom six. Good size, could be physical. He was traded to Toronto to get back Philip Hallander. And then Toronto used him and exposed him in the expansion draft so they could keep Kerfoot. So basically, the swap, I forgot what the whole package deal was, but it was something more like McCann for, I guess you could look it at McCann. And if I'm forgetting somebody else, I apologize. But a McCann to get Philip Hallander back. Remember, you traded Philip Hallander and your first round pick to Toronto the previous year for Kasperi Kapanen. And I was pretty mad about that. I'm like, why are you trading Hallander for? You trade the first round pick, fine, but don't trade Hallander. He's one of your top prospects. You barely have any prospects. And he was one of those guys that was drafted above round three, and the Pens had that issue for years about keeping high round draft picks. But in any event, they got rid of McCann, so he's gone. Brandon Tanev, all right, yeah, they love him. The Canadian media loves this guy. They talk about him like he's a real X factor, decisive, and he's exciting. He's physical. I get it. But he's moved on to Seattle, and you will survive without him. Trust me. Cody Ceci, I saw a huge spike in ice time during the playoffs. He was always, to me, he was a bottom six guy, bottom pairing guy. But he got elevated in the postseason. He had a couple of good games in the postseason. So, of course, UFA, he gets a contract. Now he's an Edmonton Oiler. So we'll see how that goes. Colton Sevier, part of the big trade with Florida involving Matheson. And I forgot who went the other way. But he was a pretty good player for Florida. A good bottom six. With Pittsburgh, he was a straight fourth liner. And he didn't even play in the playoffs. He was healthy. He didn't play in the playoffs. So he's gone. He went to Edmonton as well. Frederick Gaudreau is an interesting story because he was tearing it up in the minor leagues. He got called up. He played, I think, 10 to 15 games for the Penguins. Did pretty well with them. Played center and wing. So I guess he was a UFA. He parlayed that into a contract with Minnesota. And then Mark Jankowski, same situation as Sevier, right? Played most of the season as a center, fourth line center. Didn't play in the playoffs. The Pens couldn't, was he good? Was Sevier and Jankowski really going to make the difference in the playoffs? No. So he's gone. He's gone over to the New Jersey Devils. I think Sam Miletich is gone, a prospect. But for the most part, this offseason was where most of the Pens prospects were on the contract. We'll touch on that in a second. The additions, I kind of like them. Brock McGinn, a depth guy, a physical guy with size, played for Carolina. Durable. Physical, tough. So he basically replaces Tanev. Danton Heinen could play right wing or left wing. Was on Anaheim last year, but he was pretty effective for the Bruins for a couple of years when the Bruins were one of the better teams in the league. They still are, but when Heinen had a role on a cup contender, that's pretty good. So he'll be a checking type. Dominic Simone, remember you drafted him in 2015. He had a couple of decent seasons for the Pens. Well, he's back. After being in Calgary, a failed season in Calgary, so he plays wing as well. And then you brought in Taylor Fadun, the right defenseman from Dallas. He's like a seventh or eighth or ninth guy. He's barely going to play this year. And there are other guys, too, that they brought in. Like I said, Brian Boyle's on a PTO. Bartkowski's on a PTO. But there shouldn't be many surprises with the roster this year. If you watch the last game against the Islanders, and then you went into a deep sleep and hibernation, and then you're waking up on October 13th or 14th or whenever the season starts, you're not going to see many changes. Profound, significant changes. Except for the fact that Crosby and Malkin are hurt. So let's have this exercise where let's focus on the Pens lineup with Crosby and Malkin in it, because I think that's the way it's going to look when the season matters the most for them, which is going to be the postseason, late, March, April, May timeframe. So the top six, again, one of the best in the game. Gensel, Crosby, Rust, Malkin, Kapanen, Zucker, or Rust with Malkin. You can do it every way you want. But that, I know Zucker's the guy that's been criticized. He said he had a bad year. I saw the quotes. He needs to shoot more of this shit. Whatever. You're still pretty good. He's still a pretty good player. And Jason Zucker having a career worst season or close to it, the Pens still were on 113-point pace and won the division. And so what that'll do is, considering how much money he makes and his experience and how much he has left in the tank, then you could slot Jeff Carter on a third line, and it could be an effective third line, whether it's Zach Aston-Reese on one wing or Heinen or Simone or Sam Lafferty, or Brock McGinn. It'll be an effective third line. Now, the fourth line is kind of up in the air. The third line is going to be a similar combination with the wings, but who's the center going to be? Is it going to be Teddy Bluger? Is it going to be Evan Rodriguez? Brian Boyle? I read something that this kid Zahorna, the older kid, the Czech kid, I think, or Slovak that you signed, that he's got a shot to be the fourth line center. And you got to figure with Crosby Malkin out, you just take everybody up and slide them up two spots. So to start the season on opening night, you'll probably have Carter and Bluger as your one and two centers. And then Boyle and Zahorna, or Boyle and Bluger, or Zahorna and Bluger as your bottom two centers. Something like that. I mean, I'm trying to figure how it'll work out. But a lot of these guys that they've had in Wilkes-Barre Scranton the last couple of years, they're going to see time in the NHL. Specifically the forwards, not as much the defense. The defense looks fine. Top pairing, Dumoulin, Letang, aces. All right, Letang's coming up on free agency, so who knows what to expect. You always got to worry about him with his health, but he's been, like I said, Norris caliber season. You're still getting him out of Chris Letang. He's still playing 25, 27 minutes a game. At least, you know, in the playoffs, or whatever it was. Second pairing, whether it's Matheson and Pettersson and Marino, I don't know. I mean, I guess you could say Marino-Matheson as the middle pairing. Marino's a really good player. You stole him from Edmonton. Matheson, I've been a little bit critical of, but, you know, he seemed to do pretty well last year. I really like Marcus Pettersson. You stole him from Anaheim. I think it was the Sprong trade. So your first five defensemen look set, though. I mean, obviously the left side, Dumoulin, Matheson, Pettersson, and the right side, Letang, Marino. Thereafter, who knows? Rue Riedel, he could be on the right side. Maybe you want to have Fadun split some time with him. You got some of these career minor league types, Mark Friedman, Mitch Reinke on the right side. The left side, the one, I guess, X factor could be Pierre-Olivier Joseph. I don't know. When I watched him play in the NHL, he's looked okay. I know Pens want more consistency out of him, but, you know, you got him in from Arizona. I believe it was the Kessel deal. So he was a former first-round pick. And, you know, like I said, the Pens like to let their guys marinate, and he's marinated. So I think he's ready. He's been through all the camps. He's played in Wilkes-Barre. He's had a prominent role there. He's played in Pittsburgh. You also have Juuso Riikola, Cam Lee, the prospect Almari. They could play the left side. Matt Bartowski. Okay, we'll see what he becomes. He's on a PTO. But really, look who we're talking about here. We're talking about 6th, 7th, 8th defensemen. Not going to make or break your season. I think Dumoulin, Letang, Matheson, Marino, Pettersson, it's a very good first five. And that is capable of being matched up against the best lines and best forwards in the Metro Division, in the Eastern Conference, and in the entire league. Goaltending is pretty, I think, set with Jarry and Casey DeSmith, right? Jarry being the number one, DeSmith being the number two. And then now as far as WBS goes, I mean, you'll have Louis Domingue. You got the kid from UMass Lindgren. He was on, was he on Minnesota? And they didn't sign him, but he's a freebie. You picked him up. Alex DiOrio had a pretty decent showing in the AHL last year. Then you have Tommy Napier. And then, of course, you got the two European goalies, but they'll be in Europe this year. Cali Klang and Blomqvist, the Finnish kid. So goaltending, depth-wise, shouldn't be a problem. I guess what we're looking to see is if Tristan Jarry can replicate what he did last year during the regular season. But when you go into the postseason, you might say, oh, here we go again. We'll see how this turns out. Because now, if you go have another strong regular season, you're going there with Jarry. He falters. Now you got to turn to DeSmith. And that's when a former goalie like Hextall's like, I don't fucking want these guys. I kind of fell in on them. I got to go out and get myself a fucking goalie. And that's probably what they're going to do. The issue is, you know, how are you going to acquire that? What are you willing to pay? Who's going to be available? And, you know, the cap situation is very complex for the Pens. We'll provide that overview in a little bit. But as a whole, this is a Stanley Cup contending roster. When healthy. That you check all the blocks. Is Jarry a legit number one in the NHL? I guess it's safe to say right now he is. He's still kind of unproven to a degree. But you were able to improve without Matt Murray. And that, you know, those first three centers, Crosby, Malkin, Carter, it's outstanding. Top nine is one of the best in the league. Top six is one of the top three or four in the league. Top nine is one I would say easily top five or top seven, top eight that I've, overviewed thus far. This is, I think, the 23rd team I've done that depends on paper have one of the best attacks in the game. And then obviously the numbers back it up. I mean, every year they're finishing with the top power play, one of the top power plays, one of the top in shots generated, goals scored, five-on-five scoring. It's just it just works. And that's why it probably makes it tough to fire the coach there, Sullivan, because you're getting results. Now, obviously some coaches will get fired because of postseason and the one playoff series will trump in a full 82-game schedule. We've seen that happen before. But the big, I guess, X factor is going to be how well these depth guys perform in elevated roles while Crosby and Malkin are out. And there's not a whole lot to choose from. You know, if you're a Pens fan, I'm sure you're in love with Jordy Bellerive. You're in love with frickin' Felix Robert. You're in love with Kasper Bjorkqvist, Pustinen, and Kyle Olsen, and Jan Drazd. Yeah, okay, you're in love with them. Well, guess what? You're in love with them because that's all you got. You know, like they say, you have to love your kids. Well, some people get real shitty kids. You got it. You still got to love them, though. It's like the parent that says, oh, my kid's special. No, he's not. He's a fucking idiot. And he's a borderline criminal. And he's useless. And he's going to be a bum when he gets older. And he's going to contribute nothing to society. Well, he's my kid. I got to love him. Yeah, absolutely. Love him. Give him all the attention you want. But don't expect him to be some type of superstar, a model citizen. Like, he's far from it. Now, I'm not comparing, you know, Kyle Olsen and Nathan LaGare to criminals and, you know, the losers of society. It's an analogy. That you guys, as Pens fans, just like I is, well, not really, I'm a bad example because I try to study all the prospects, but, you know, you get attached to these kids and you start saying, oh my God, he had a goal in three NHL games. I'm so excited for next season. Whereas the other teams are like, we have like eight of the top 50 prospects in the game. Now, are those teams elite Stanley Cup contenders like the Penguins? No, not all of them. There are some teams that have a strong farm system and are contending for the Cup. Minnesota's one of them. Florida's got a pretty good farm system. Carolina's got an outstanding farm system, one of the best in the game. And they were the best team in the Eastern Conference last year, record-wise. But you are going to see these kids play. But just remember that Pens have only had 35 picks in the last seven combined drafts. 35, that's seven drafts. Seven times seven is 49. So if you had 14 less picks than what you automatically allocated, you had 21 picks automatically given to you between rounds one and three. What the Pens end up with after all the trades and the, you know, the cup runs and all this other shit, 13 in the last 7 years. Only 13 picks in rounds one through three since 2015. And of those 13 higher round picks, only seven are still with the organization. And only one, Poulin, is a first round pick. So all these guys that you're seeing, that you're going to see this year in Pittsburgh while Crosby and Malkin heal up, these are not the top prospects in hockey. They're the top prospects in the Penguins organization, and the Pens have one of the worst farm systems in the game. So the downside to having a bottom five prospect pool every season is the uncertainty that's going to plague the lineup when a star or two or three is out with an injury. Now, granted, Pittsburgh's got a solid track record of allowing the overdeveloped AHLers a shot at a regular shift on a contending team, no less. But if the Pens falter early this season without Crosby and Malkin to bail them out, it's an easy scapegoat is the lack of depth in the organization, i.e. the lack of draft picks and a poor track record at developing, well, not really developing, but just accumulating future NHL talent. And that not having high draft picks, either traded or misused or, you know, retired, whatever, that's going to be the driving force behind the lack of scoring, which is what some people are anticipating with Crosby and Malkin being out. I could be wrong. Could be a different situation where guys, these rookies show up and like, oh my God, Sid who? Geno who? All right, that's probably not going to happen, but you know, you never know. So I would say that the Penguins' penchant for turning it up a notch in the second half of the season and like we talked about earlier in the podcast, solidifying their reputation as a top team in the league, a powerhouse, a cup contender, that this might also work out in their favor where, you know, for a quarter of the season, they're playing these kids. A lot of these kids are up for contracts, whether it be RFA or UFA. Some of them impress, and now a guy like, let's say, and I'm just making, let's say Zahorna or Jan Drazd or Nathan Lagare or Kasper Bjorkqvist or Justin Almeida or Jordy Bellery. Like maybe one of these guys will play so well that the Pens are like, yo, we got it. We could sell high now. We don't have to keep him. Let's trade him. Let's get some assets in return. That's something the Pens have not done. They have not maxed out on their prospects. There's the examples are few and far between where the Pens have sold high. The Pens have been very patient with a lot of their prospects. They have not sold them out or traded them or whatever. Now, you know, when the Pens make trades, they want to acquire talent. And unfortunately for them, the cost is always a high draft pick that they haven't used yet. And it goes back to the Mark Stone deal. Look at how Vegas acquired Mark Stone. They acquired Mark Stone not by trading away a first round pick. Yeah, they traded away a second round pick. Vegas did. But the previous, two seasons prior in their first year league, they had three first round picks that they did with all the drug deals that they did at the expansion draft. Cody Glass, Nick Suzuki, and Eric Brandstrom. And that Vegas used the first two of those picks, or the second two, with Suzuki and Brandstrom, to get Max Pacioretty and Mark Stone, two of their best forwards. Guys that have been to the, you know, 35 goal scorers. Stone, obviously, an elite Selke caliber defensive forward. Eric Brandstrom was like the crown jewel of the return for Ottawa in the Mark Stone trade. That they literally acquired one of the best two-way forwards in the game, if not the best, and didn't even in his prime. And it didn't even call. Now he was a UFA and they had the money to pay him, but still. All it caught, and I remember George McPhee saying, I had killed me getting rid of Eric Brandstrom. Now Brandstrom was having his struggles in Ottawa. So that trade is looking even better for Vegas. But the point is that you need to have both. Because that's going to improve the quality of plays you get in return. Forget about the cap. If the Pens had draft picks and prospects, then they'd be able to be involved more in these discussions at the trade deadline. Instead of this cycle just keeps continuing. We want Jeff Carter, trade high picks. At some point, it's got to stop. They have to. And Hextall, his track record with Philly was, you know, hoarding picks. And I think that was the knock on him, is that he was too patient. The opposite of, let's say, Jim Rutherford, or before him, Ray Shiro. Where they're like, oh, fuck it, we got Sid and Gino in their prime, and Letang, and, you know, Flower. Like, get rid of these picks. I don't give a fuck about them. So you'll see these kids play. Hopefully, and that'll be, I think, the best case scenario. Is that not only do these kids play and produce, but the Pens are also able to stem the tide. They're one of the top teams in the division. Sid and Gino come back. You're looking at another, let's say, 48 to 52 win season. And give it another go in the playoffs. But that's, I think, best case scenario, obviously. Best case, and I'm not talking about winning the Stanley Cup. I'm saying how this season's going to unfold because of all the question marks that are driven by this injury problem with Crosby and Malkin. All right, let's move on and talk about the salary cap. Now, the salary cap goes without saying, right, with the Pens. They spend up to the cap. All right, always near the upper limit. They rarely have cap space. The examples of them finding ways to move pieces here and there and get themselves a little bit of breathing room, very rare. But as of right now, not the optimal position to be in. They have $122,000 in cap space with 46 out of 50 contracts. 1.17 mil this season in dead space. That's from the Jack Johnson buyout. And then next year jumps to 1.9 mil. And then thereafter, you only have 3 years left, and it's only 917K. So you could deal with that. But, you know, I guess it's going to be big, you know, to a degree. But listen, it's a huge offseason for the Pens. Forget about what's going on 2-3 years down the road. This upcoming offseason is going to be incredibly busy for Pittsburgh. Malkin, Letang, Jeff Carter, Brian Russ, Zach Aston-Reese, and Casey DeSmith are all unrestricted free agents. And Kasperi Kapanen is an RFA, and you already have about $48 million committed to 2022-23. In total, if you count the AHLers and the prospects, the Penguins have 14 RFAs and 14 UFAs, 28 players playing for a contract. And again, that might be a good thing. Might motivate these guys to work a little harder, spend more time in the gym, spend more time watching film. Got to maintain that lifestyle. No one wants to kind of be left stranded and have to worry about where the next paycheck's coming from, right? Oh, I got to go to Europe now, whatever. No. And that, I think, is going to create intense competition. So this is another factor when you're trying to project how a team's going to finish in the standings. I don't have the numbers on me, but I think that when you have a ton of guys playing for contracts, i.e. like, what, 75% of the roster is going to be playing for a new contract next season. Well, really, not just the roster, the organization. If you count the prospects, those that aren't in college or in Europe, that the intense competition is going to allow the cream to rise to the top. And that's what you want. You want the best players in the best positions, and those are the guys that are going to get rewarded for it financially. I don't have the numbers to prove it, but I just think that it might be a positive to have this many guys playing for a contract. Because they know the cap's going up. Fans are going to be back in the stands. Hockey-related revenue is going to skyrocket compared to what it dealt with or what the numbers were from the COVID hits. Now, another thing to consider, though, is that out of these, like, 28 pending free agents, how many were acquired by Burke and Hextall? Most of them aren't there, guys. So it's reasonable to expect a massive roster overhaul from the top down. And a lot of that, of course, is driven by either a regular season collapse or an early exit. I mean, shit, if the Pens win a cup or go to the conference final and they get, you know, great seasons out of Aston-Reese and Casey DeSmith has to take over for an ineffective Jarry. So now you're like, all right, well, they did their job. I'm not going to pay him fucking $8 million a year, but let someone else do it. But, you know. So it'll be interesting to see how it all unfolds, because let's say the Pens do have a strong season. Do Hextall and Burke say, hey, you know what, let's bring them all back. They deserve it. Or do they say, I don't give a fuck. Let them walk. I want to build my team with my vision, or our team in our vision. We've been waiting for this moment, waiting for all these guys to hit free agency. Now it's time to trade them away to deadline if we can, or trade away whoever we can, not qualify whoever we can, and just start fresh. Oh, you know, but the names, I mean, I'm going to give you a list of all the names. Malkin, Rust, Carter, Aston-Reese, Rodriguez, Lafferty, Letang, Ruedel, DeSmith, Ricola, Fadoon, Simon. Is it Chapeau? Kaput? Whatever it is. And Louis Domingue. They're your UFAs. And then your RFAs. These are the same names, right, we've been talking about in the farm system. Or, you know, Kasperi Kapanen, we were talked about. But Danton Heinen, who just brought in as an RFA. Mark Friedman, you just brought him in. Actually, he played in Wilkes-Barre Scranton last year. But Cam Lee, Drew O'Connor, Pierre-Olivier Joseph, Almari, Jan Drozd, Almeida, Will Riley, Casper Bjorkqvist, Jordy Bellreeve, Alex DiOrio, the goalie, and Anthony Angelo, all RFA. Some, you know, they range between 21 and 25. And they're not all needle movers. You know, you heard the names. But again, doesn't take away from the fact that a lot of work. A lot of work. It's not going to be easy for Hextall and Burke and his capologist and his staff, because they may have to restructure the entire roster. Only three forwards are signed beyond next season. Crosby and McGinn are UFAs in 2025, and Gensel's a UFA in 2024. Everybody else is kind of flapping in the wind, either this year or next. All right, let's talk about the schedule. And interesting. I did all the research. I crunched all the numbers. And based on what I've seen, there's some favorable aspects to the schedule. And I'm not, you could say that about anything, but no, some schedules have been brutal and some schedules have been easy. Pens have pluses and minuses. I don't think that the schedule is hard, will be too hard for them to overcome, regardless of who's healthy or not. But there are, I think, two blocks, specifically after the first half, or close to the end of the first half, one hard stretch and one easy stretch, specifically towards the end of the season, that will really decide the season for the Pens. And so, like, your first, you know, like, you're playing the Metro Division. Now, one thing's in your favor is that, you know, you only play five teams four times, two home, two road, and two teams in the division, you only play three. It's just to balance out the schedule. So one of those teams you play three times is going to be twice at home, one on the road, and then the other one's going to be one at home and two on the road. Well, the league schedule makers did the Pens a solid because they subtracted a game apiece from the Islanders and Carolina. So, from a preseason prediction standpoint, if you want to say that the Islanders and Carolina are the two best teams in the division, the Islanders for going to back-to-back conference finals and giving Tampa a hard time in the playoffs, Carolina for having the best record in the conference last year, you're playing the Islanders only three times, once at home, two on the road, and Carolina only three times, two at home, one on the road. So you basically lost a home game with the Islanders and a road game with Carolina. And it could have been Columbus or the Devils or the Rangers, who might be an easier matchup. So that works out in your favor. But Washington, Philly, Rangers, Devils, Columbus, you play them all four times. Monthly spread, 8 in October, 14 in November, 13 in December, 15 in January, only 4 in February, that's the Olympic break, 15 in March, and only 13 in April. So that's another big deal, that you don't have the last month of the season packed in and you run the risk of guys burning out. That 28 games over the final 61 days, that's not bad. Some teams have it way tougher. But the first 26 games of the season are going to be tough, because 18 of those games are going to be against either fellow contenders or near contenders. You start off the season with a two-game Florida trip. That's your season start, at Tampa, at Florida. So right off the bat, challenge, two challenges. But then it's back to Pittsburgh for an eight-game homestand, and in that homestand, you got some toughies. Chicago at home, then Dallas, Toronto, critical game. Tampa Bay, critical game. Then Calgary, the Devils, Philly, and Minnesota, another cup contender to close it out. If the host in the Wild on November 6th to close out that homestand, the Pens play 12 of the next 16 on the road. And some of those games include at Washington, at Montreal, at Toronto, at Winnipeg, at the Islanders, at Edmonton, and at Washington again. So this tough stretch that starts on... Well, early November, it ends around December 10th with that home date against the Capitals. But once you play the Capitals on the 10th, it kicks off a light portion of the schedule. And it's a lengthy chunk. It's about 28 games long, mid-season. And it begins with a home date against Anaheim on December 11th. And it ends in Columbus on February 27th. But in this stretch, the Penguins played 21 teams to make the playoffs last year. And the only quote-unquote tough games are at Boston on December 27th, at Toronto on December 29th. Those are back-to-back. At Vegas on the 17th of January, and then Washington at home on February 1st. So highly critical part of the season. Because not only is it easy, but it's also around the same time that Crosby and Malkin should be at midseason form. It's also important because the death murder stretch, probably the toughest part of the schedule for the Penguins, begins in Tampa Bay on March 3rd and ends in St. Louis on March 17th. So a two-week stretch, very difficult. I mean, this is going to be bananas. At Tampa, at Carolina, Florida at home, at the Islanders, Vegas at home, Carolina at home, and then you wrap it up with at Nashville and at St. Louis. So obviously Nashville and St. Louis aren't cup contenders, but they're still tough matchups because they'll be on the road. Once you come off of that tough stretch, though, you get a bit of a respite because the next six games are at Arizona, Columbus at home, at Buffalo, at the Rangers, Detroit at home, and then the Rangers at home. So all winnable. You could easily go 6-0 in that. But the final 14 games, they're either going to break the Pens in two or prime them for the rigors of the Eastern Conference playoffs. At Minnesota, at Colorado, at the Rangers, Washington at home, Nashville at home, Columbus at home. But then it's Islanders at home, at Boston, home against Boston, at Detroit, at Philly. And it's to close out the season at home. Your last two games are Edmonton and Carolina. So if it ever comes down to playoff seeding and jockeying, you know, five of your last six games or, well, six of your last seven games are Islanders at home, home and home with Boston, at Detroit, at Philly, Edmonton and Carolina at home. Not easy. But you could only hope that that easy-ish 28-game portion, and we're talking about, you know, a third of the season. You'll have Crosby and Malkin back. You'll be able to make headway with that. If you had any issues to start the season with that tough stretch, you could overcome it. And then if you're playing so well after that 28-game stretch, then you'll become just as tough a matchup for those elite cup contenders as they are to you. Like, Tampa's going to be like, oh, shit, we got to play Pittsburgh. I don't say, shit, we got to play Pittsburgh. It's not all doom and gloom. It's not like no one's licking their chops to play the Penguins. I don't care. You know, you got Crosby and Malkin in there, and they're healthy, and the offense is hitting on all cylinders. Then, you know what? Business as usual, really. All right, let's talk about the farm system real quick. We've already touched on some of the names and kind of outline the situation that's facing, I guess, the player development arm of the Penguins. Obviously, not having a lot of draft picks has hurt them. They don't have a very good or deep farm system. If I would identify one strength within the organization, it has to be in goal. The defense core, prospect pool-wise, is okay. You know, they added Isaac Béliveau and Ryan McCleary at this last draft. They signed, actually, Béliveau. They got Josh Maniscalco. I don't think they drafted him. He was a free agent signee. He's a defenseman for Arizona State, but they signed him, so he should be in the AHL this year. But really, like, the number one prospect, defense prospect they have is probably Pierre-Olivier Joseph or Almari, the Finnish kid. Clayton Phillips is going to be in Penn State for another year. I think it's his senior year. But the goalies, Blomqvist, Klang, DiOrio, that's pretty good. I mean, you have three kids with potential number one upside. Obviously, Blomqvist and Klang being higher than DiOrio, but still, DiOrio was a pretty good goalie in the Quebec League. The center ice position's a problem. You went out, you drafted Chase Yoda, good two-way type. He's in college. John Gruden that you got from Ottawa. I forgot what trade that was, but you got him from Ottawa, former NTDP kid. But everybody else is, you know, Robert or Robert. I apologize, whatever it is, if I made a mistake. Angelo, Bellerive, Liam Gorman. I don't even know if Liam Gorman is still with the organization anymore. The X factor, I guess, is Kirill Tankov. Kirill Tankov, the kid, remember I ranked him 75th overall in 2020. He didn't get drafted. And then they drafted him in the 7th round last year. The thing about Tankov is, and I've already explained this, I'll say it again, that Skaver Yagi is the farm system for Scott 1946, but they both play in the same league. So it's like basically Wilkes-Barre Scranton playing in the Metro Division with the Penguins. And the Penguins beat the shit out of them, And they say, oh, we beat the shit out of you, but this guy right here, he's good, so he gets to play for us next game. And, you know, so it's almost having your farm system is in your division. It's the weirdest thing ever. But in any event, Tankov has always been the number one guy for Ska Vayagi, the farm system for Ska 1946. The difference is that they're all, it's all U20. The kids are all aged between 16 and 21. And Tankov was the number one center for Ska Vayagi. When he played against the top teams in the MHL, the Russian Junior League, he did great. He looked like a legit number one. But the few times they called him up to Ska 1946, he was kind of like on the outside looking in. He's not a heralded prospect, right? They have Husnadinov. They had Artem Zuk. They had, what was the kid's name? Kovalenko. No, I'm sorry, Siplikov. I always get those two confused. Siplikov. They had a whole bunch of guys. Kroviakov, I'm sorry. So deep at center ice, no room for Tankov. So he stays at Ska Vayagi. Well, this year, he was expected to be the number one center on Ska 1946. Instead, he gets promoted to the VHL, to Ska Neva, right? Neva's the river up there near St. Petersburg, the big river. So he plays for Ska Neva, or Neva, whatever it is. And he's one of the best players on the team this year, playing against adults. And he's only, I think, 19 or 20. So promising development coming out of Russia, because that's really all you got. Now, Chase Yoder's a college kid, and he's probably going to be a three-year type, but at least a three-year type. Good news on the wings, because you got Philip Hallander back. So now you could say that Hallander and Poulin on the left side, and then maybe Legare, Pustinin, maybe Judd Caulfield, maybe Lucas Svejkovsky. The wings aren't bad. And then, of course, you drafted Tristan Brose, who, in my opinion, is first-round caliber in the second round last year. But again, you don't have the ass. You don't have the ass to compete with the big boys, pipeline-wise. So the question is, when does it change? When? The Pens have not drafted seven or more. You already guaranteed seven picks. I think the last time the Pens had seven picks or more in a draft was the Matt Murray, Derek Pouliot, Olli Maatta draft of, 2013? I think it was 2012. That was, of course, with Maatta and Pouliot being first-round picks. But I don't know. Oh, a Sundqvist, Oscar Sundqvist. And, of course, you traded him to St. Louis, the ill-fated trade, Ryan Reeves. And you trade away basically Klim Kostin, the Russian wing prospect, and Sundqvist. And Sundqvist was a key figure on a cup-winning team. But that was the last time, so I don't know, maybe try doing it again. Even if you have to draft nothing but sixth and seventh rounders, if you got to trade a guy like freaking Anthony Angelo or, Justin Almeida or Will Riley. I mean, if you got to get do it. Or how about do this? Before you start trading second and third round picks, or first round picks, why don't you trade a second, but try to do a draft day deal during the season? I know that's rare to do, but it's an option, I guess an alternative. That add draft capital before you sell everything off at the deadline. To say, hey, we've just acquired three extra draft picks by dealing away these career minor leaguers. So why not? Now we could say, you know what? We got 2 sevenths, 2 fifths, a sixth, 2 fourths. Let's go ahead and trade our first or second round pick. And maybe we can make some moves where we could package 2 fourths for a third, the 2 sevenths for a sixth, and so on and so forth. I don't know. Do something. But until that happens, you're going to have one of the worst prospect pools in the league. And that's why you have to be concerned. Not overly concerned, because you still got a couple of years, it looks like, under this current group. But what if it gets to the point where, like, you all you have to rely on is your farm system? And let's say when you finally get cap space, you can't say, hey, we'll just plug the kids in. They deserve it. They work their asses off. It's time to give them a shot. You can't do that. To stay competitive, you're going to go out, and what are you going to do? You're going to overpay for unrestricted free agents. You're going to try to guarantee it that when the time comes to replace Crosby and Malkin and Letang, that the Pens are going to, if they don't change what they're doing, that they will try to address the issue with unrestricted free agents. And good luck with that. Sometimes it works. Most of the time it doesn't. You need a farm system to help bridge that gap. And we'll see if it happens. All right. Hour and 10 minutes in the books. Thank you for listening in. Episode number 173. We talked about the Pittsburgh Penguins in their upcoming season. Don't forget, you can find the podcast on SoundCloud, iTunes, and Spotify. Give me a follow on Twitter at The Draft Analyst. The YouTube page is called Prospect Film Room. And the free draft blog is located at thedraftanalyst.com. So buckle up, enjoy the season. Hope you guys stay safe. We'll see you guys next time.